in moderating this event. And we have a very important speaker there. So today I request you humbly to stick to the schedule, because once you go there, sit at table, start talking, you forget that there is an exit. This particular session is Rethinking Education. Should moral and religious education be at the heart of the learning process? Dr. K.P. Mishra is the moderator of this session. Dr. Mishra is an eminent scientist of India. He pursued scientific research career in permanent employment in Bhabha Atomic Research Center, Department of Atomic Energy, Mumbai, for more than four decades, and grew upward from position to next position, superannuated as senior scientist and head of radiation biology and health sciences division of the center, invited as adjunct professor at the Department of Life Sciences, University of Mumbai, and at the Institute of Technology, Manipal Academy of Higher Education. Honored with the invitation to hold the position of Vice Chancellor, Nehru Gram Bharati University, a deemed university, Allahabad, from 2010 to 2014. He was elected a Fellow of National Academy of Sciences, India. He is the founder president of Society of Radiation Researchers, India, and president of Asian Association of Radiation Research. Dr. Mishra has a distinguished career and is also an educationist. I request Dr. Mishra to chair the session and moderate it. Thank you.
Good evening to each one of you. We are going to start the session, which is delayed apparently by 15 minutes. So we apologize to you. That is after shifting of the program. We are further delayed by 15 minutes. We welcome to this session, which is session on education, about which Sadhvi Chaitanya Pragyaji mentioned in the inaugural session. I am educationist, scientist, and a thinker. For me, education session is at the heart of my personality. I like to think about education a lot, and to talk about education is my passion, hobby. And this session is devoted to the utility of moral and ethical education in the teaching and learning process. So very important, and religious part is having both the aspects, good part and bad part. We have to understand how to make it positive. We have to also examine whether religious teaching is doing good to society or it is not doing that good as expected. And we have now here on the panel, including myself, six speakers. It is 145 minutes session. Each speaker gets 15 minutes. And then at the end, if I get some time, then I will talk about. So first, I am not taking any time, only to introduce you what we expect. Now to my panelists, the focus is to try and orient your talk and your thought to the idea that why religious teaching is important, and if it is not important, then what are the shortcomings, and also to check how moral and ethical component of education is missing or is included, which way it benefits. And the lastly important point organizers have put is the teaching and learning process. That is important, that whether teaching has worked and converted into learning or not, that part is important. So each one of you get 15 minutes, but if you have finished early, That means if we have taken less time than 15 minutes and we have spare time, then we will give that time to audience. So please be aware of this, that audience should get enough time. I would like to thank Professor Gandhi for giving very charitable and generous remark about my biodata. And I would also like to thank all organizers who are now friends, that they gave me a chance to talk to you this evening for this session. So I will be with you actively for 1 hour 45 minutes. You are free to generate your question now and later and during the discussion. And I would like to see that active participation goes on this question. And we try and see that what we have learned in 1 hour 45 minutes. So with this, I would welcome you again for this session, and I welcome all the panelists on the dais. And we now give the dais to the first speaker of the session. The first speaker of the session is Tara Sethia, and she is going to give you first talk. And let me introduce her. She has a very laudable biodata, professor of history, founder and director of Ahimsa Center at California Institute of Polytechnic University. She led the establishment of interdisciplinary minor and nonviolence studies on her campus and directs Summer Institute of K-12 Educators on Journeys of Nonviolence, which is the main theme here. She has also organized several international conferences, course of public lectures, and dialogues focusing on practical aspects of nonviolence. Her books include Living Gandhi, Lessons for Our Times, Pioneer of Nonviolence Social Change, and numerous articles, books, chapters, reviews. Professor Sethia received PhD in History from University of California, Los Angeles, MA in History from University of Rajasthan, India. With this introduction, I welcome you to give your talk. And your time begins now. You can use this or this. Okay. Okay. So you can put this on.
One second.
Put it a little bit there, then you fall down.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I would make a case for education about nonviolence. And I will also argue that although all religions regard nonviolence as a fundamental value, nonviolence doesn't really need any religion. It can stand on itself. And even an atheist can be a nonviolent person. So the case that I'm going to make today is for nonviolence education. So the need for integrating in education the learning and teaching of nonviolence is relevant and urgent in our contemporary context. In my presentation this afternoon, I will focus on the following: the relevance of nonviolence and the urgency of making it an educational priority in our contemporary context. Number two, I will talk about what is nonviolence and why and how it is different from violence. And third, I will draw upon my own experience as the founder and director of Ahimsa Center at California State University in Pomona, United States, and share some of the sustainable educational strategies for integrating an understanding of nonviolence and nonviolent social change in schools and colleges. The case for the relevance of nonviolence is powerfully made in this, it's summed up powerfully in this, and the logic in this passage. Just as pain is not agreeable to you, it is so with others. Knowing this principle of equality of all beings, treat all with respect and compassion. Even though this comes from a religious text, you can see the secularity of this passage. It is not drawing on any notion of karma or heaven or hell, rather a very modern notion of equality of all beings. And I think that's very, very important to understand. I also, before I proceed further, would like to point out that my comments today are made in the context of the United States education, and I'm not talking about anywhere else. So all the points that I will be making today are really in the context of the US, which may be applicable to India and to some other nations. Now, what makes this passage powerful is that it is not just meant to be a theoretical exercise. After exhorting us to first reflect on the logic of equality of all beings, none of whom desire pain, it calls us to action by asking us to treat all living beings with respect and compassion. However, in our current context, the relevance of nonviolence education assumes a critical urgency. Daily news reports are marked by cases of road rage, sky rage, and sideline rage, not to mention the increasing instances of terror, unending stories of horror about wars, and growing global conflicts leading to death and destruction. Around us, we see discord and divisions deepening, inequalities increasing, and animosities rising. Violence is pervading all walks of our lives, homes, schools, colleges, airports, streets, game fields, and workplaces. Most disturbing, however, is the growing trend of violence in schools and college campuses, which does not bode well for the future of humanity. The sad truth is that our children and youngsters, again, in the American context, our children and youngsters are growing up seeing violence not only as normal, but also necessary and in some cases even cool. Violence in schools and colleges occur in various forms, ranging from bullying to killing. Such violence results in multiple deaths, destruction of property. More than 15% students in the United States skip school because of fear of attack or harm. More than 40,000 students and 8,000 teachers are attacked in American schools each month. America stands out in the world as the number one nation in gun violence. But what is even more telling about American exceptionalism is that we are doing so little to reduce such violence and much less to promote a culture of nonviolence. Schools rely on anti-violence interventions like school surveillance, police presence, metal detectors, all of which engender extremely negative psychological and emotional environments in schools, thus making students feel increasingly stressed, frustrated, alienated, and confused. Although such actions may sometimes be necessary or even expedient, they do not create a positive environment for nurturing peace and harmony. While it is important that we move away from violence, it is even more important to devise ways for creating and sustaining a culture of nonviolence. How can this be achieved? So here I first talk about, in order to achieve something, we should know what we want to achieve. And in that sense, I want to first juxtapose before you what is nonviolence and how and why it is different from violence. Often nonviolence is defined as the absence of violence or harm. However, nonviolence is not merely the absence of violence, just as peace is not simply the absence of war. Nonviolence and violence are in fact very different in terms of their premises, goals, modalities of action, and outcomes. Nonviolence is rooted in unity, in oneness, in the integrity of the whole. This sense of unity applies within the individual, as in mind-body harmony, or in unity of thought and action, and on a larger scale.